Boston had a distinct role in the history of jazz, and in the 20th century, jazz becomes the American music. Some places are synonymous with jazz. New Orleans, Kansas City, Chicago, New York has a vivid jazz scene. Boston's is somewhat different, as there isn't a distinct Boston sound. Instead, musicians come from Boston and musicians come to Boston.
Better tell the public that we're going to have some really torrid tempo with Charlie Parker, the alto sax, and Diz at the trumpet, and Dick Hyman's at the piano. They're going to play, what is it?
I think it's Hot House.
Hot House? Okay, fellas, let's go.
Gloves and my hat and my pearls. I knew exactly what I was to do.
So we have a critical mass of musicians and a critical mass of an audience for musicians. And here at places like the Savoy Cafe.
Math Ave was swinging, and the Savoy was
right,
up on Math Ave.
That was a little bit after that.
See, and so that's a little before my time. So when you told me that the Savoy was at West Newton and Columbus.
That's right. That was
huge. Yeah, I don't know. I hadn't quite gotten it.
You know what causes
hi-hat becomes an after-hours place for jazz musicians to go, and you might see Duke Ellington or Sarah Vaughan or Ella Fitzgerald performing premier jazz entertainment. Really, the heart of Boston's jazz scene was Massachusetts Avenue and Columbus Avenue, which was the jazz corner of Boston. Clubs foster a community for men and women who are passing through. Also an African-American community here. And in addition, there is a musical community.
The Jazz Workshop down on Boylston Street in Boston. The band, Herbie Hancock's new band.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is WBCN in Boston. This is B.B. King. Get down with it.
All right.
Well, who is performing tonight with Mel Jackson?
Well, the trio behind him.
And Miles Davis looking resplendent in a sort of red or orangish type outfit.
We're at the Jazz Workshop at 733 Boylston Street, and we'll be bringing you Donald Byrd.
Here I am, and Keith is down at the piano.
Lenny's evolved. We rented it. We opened it as a roadhouse. I filled the jukebox with jazz records. And before you know it, we were hiring Sonny Stitt and Zoot Sims. It became known on the Turnpike as a unique location where one could hear jazz. Because it was small, it was compact. And it had somebody who was interested in the music. We didn't start out as anything but a roadhouse. Telescoped, you know. As we got a response, we hired musicians from Boston.
Just musicians in the house. And then when you get, you know, really technical and play a lot of crazy things, you find yourself playing in front of an audience of musicians. You know, they just come to see what, how fast you can play, what kind of time signatures you're doing and all that stuff. But I get a reward of, like, you know, when you got people's head, you know, like a mixture of just listeners.
Mm-hmm. rock was in style. It was hip to the kids that all the cats at Berkeley were playing. It was wild stuff. But it was complicated and didn't fit the club scene at all. Couple big old clubs around town closed up in the early 70s. But not because of the jazz rock. The old days were on their way out. Keeping the old days alive, however, were the college kids.
I find it more wholesome than in the nightclub alcohol dope fiend type of situation. Yes. You know, it's a little more wholesome playing for students. They're clean and they're trying to learn. Mm-hmm. And they appreciate, if you give a good performance, I think a little more.
So much about this college, and to come and to be invited here, gee, was a dream of mine to come true. Scared to death too.
You understand what the word Berkeley means? Now, now.
Boston was going through changes, and so did jazz as the decade went on. The future of jazz after the 70s were the music students.
The situation in Boston has recently taken a turn for the worse. The limited seating capacity of such places, coupled with the rising cost of hiring artists to perform, has made the Paul's Mall Jazz Workshop Complex shut its doors 3 weeks ago, a victim of rising prices.
Here, me.
One less place we have to work, one less place we have to come and tell our story.
It is absolutely tragic. And it's a shame that the American government and the American society will let something like this happen.
It's 800.
Without the club, and especially without the workshop room, it's likely that the performers who play there will only be available in large concert performances, and that means less jazz for Boston. Milt Jackson and Fred Taylor, owner of the Jazz Workshop in Paul's Mall, are both worried about what will happen to the jazz scene in Boston. The popular mainstream performers will probably not have trouble playing here in concert. But Milt Jackson thinks it should be the responsibility of the government to assure that jazz survives. But one customer in the audience said, when asked how he felt about the club closing, "Jazz will survive. It always has before." For National Public Radio, I'm Henrietta Davis.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Hello.
Definitely a gem and a jewel in the community, Wally's Cafe. This is one of the havens where a lot of the players, a lot of the artists, a lot of the people in the community that were somebodies in certain social settings will attend. So a lot of the jazz greats will come here. This is a jazz bar. And this is where a lot of people came and socialized together and came together right here.
Wally's was really one of the only clubs in Boston that emphasized student involvement. Because of the abundance of colleges and universities in the area, Wally's jumped at the opportunity to not just showcase touring musicians, but music students as well. It was founder Joseph Wally Walcott that cleverly decided to hire these young music students and mix them in with seasoned professionals who were veterans of the big band era. This mix of talent was very special, and this format enabled Wally's to continue to serve the jazz-loving audiences of New England well after other clubs had closed their doors. Wally's kept and continues to keep the spirit of jazz and blues alive and well, and is likely the most important site for jazz in the history of Boston, located right in the heart of the genre's roots in the city.
Today, jazz in Boston continues to be prominent through the enthusiasm of the younger generations. Even if the city is without some of the more iconic clubs and venues that brought jazz to life in the city for a good part of the 20th century, places like Schuller's in Austin, the Bebop, or Wally's in the Back Bay, the Boston Pops, or the Regatta Bar in Cambridge still keep jazz alive in the city and help keep the hub a hub for one of America's most cherished art forms.
So many musicians, you know, a lot of who are older than me, some who are in their 90s, and they have been hearing that jazz has been dead since the 40s, and they laugh about this because it's said every generation. But to me, jazz is a feeling you can't get from any other kind of music, and you can't kill a feeling, so it's not going anywhere.